want to share a few words about why I'm continuing this Haydn series beyond the remaking of the 13 videos that include his 12 London symphonies and the Oxford symphony that preceded it. What we're going to encounter in this and coming videos is a very different composer from the one whose great symphonic masterpieces we've been enjoying for the last few months. I've said before that music must always be listened to in terms of what came before it, not after it. And that precept is still very much on my mind as I begin this part of the series. In fact, that brings me to one good reason for continuing the series as I am. One can much more fully understand the compositional approach Haydn took in those late masterpieces if one understands what his musical assumptions were at age 27 when he wrote his first three symphonies for his new employer, Prince Paul Anton Esterhazy. We find in these early works excellent representatives of sonata form, more or less an invention of the contemporary Mannheim school of composers, which was increasingly favored by creative musicians of Haydn's time. If you compare the sonata form approach in the Sixth Symphony with that in the 104th, you'll see something very much like a promising seed bearing its fruit almost 3.5 decades later. Another good reason for continuing this Haydn series is this. Throughout his creative life, Joseph Haydn's music spoke ringingly of a calm, ordered, rational approach to an understanding of life that for the most part has lain beyond my grasp, but whether or not I'm actually able to order my life in that way, I can appreciate the beauty of life so ordered and admire such a coherent expression of it in a medium that I love. In a word, Haydn's music feeds my hungry soul, so more Haydn it is. It seems that upon Haydn's employment as Vice-Kapellmeister in May 1761, the prince dropped a subtle hint that the composer's first three symphonies for his court might reflect three times of the day at Eisenstadt, morning, noon, and evening. So it is that Haydn's first symphonic offering in his new circumstances was a triptych of symphonies that bear those very titles. These are not programmatic works by any stretch of the imagination. They're descriptive, like Beethoven's Pastoral Symphony written almost 5 decades later, and it would be a mistake to peg particular musical details to specific events at Eisenstadt. The greatest specificity Haydn managed in them is probably the musical sunrise at the beginning of number 6 and the storm movement that closes number 8. When Prince Esterhazy hired Haydn to take charge of his orchestra, he also enlarged that orchestra, making available to the young composer pairs of flutes, oboes, and horns, a bassoon, and a chamber orchestra-sized group of string players, including at least 6 violins, 2 or 3 violas, 3 cellos, and 2 bassists. Except for the reduction of the flute representation to a single player, this is the ensemble for which Haydn composed his 6th symphony, and symphonies 7 and 8 hew closely to that pattern. Before we get started with the music, I want to draw some comparisons that I hope will be instructive. Let's look at Haydn's 6th and 104th symphonies side by side. Both are D major works in 4 movements, with their 1st, 3rd, and 4th movements set in the primary key, and movement 2 set in G major. In both, the 4 movement plan is standard, a fast sonata form movement with a slow introduction, followed by a slow movement in the subdominant key, a minuet and trio in the tonic key, but with the trio set in a darker contrasting key, and a final fast movement in sonata form. The 6th symphony is about 25 minutes long, the 104th maybe 3 minutes longer, which really isn't much. With that catalog of correspondences, the similarities between the two come to an end. In 1761, the expectation of sonata form was that both large sections of the movement, the exposition on the one hand and the development plus recapitulation on the other, would be repeated. If a coda were to be included, it would lie beyond the repeat of the second large section. Haydn gradually dropped the convention of second section repeats in his symphonies, but his young friend Mozart clung to it to the very end. Recapitulations were expected to be almost stultifyingly regular. That is, everything you heard during the exposition would be brought back during the recap in the movement's tonic key. So it is that a great deal of the Sixth Symphony's length is due to regular recapitulations and the repetition of second large sections. And this is compounded by the fact that in the Sixth Symphony, the second movement is also set in sonata form with those obligatory repeats and framed by a prologue and epilogue. Moreover, the minuet's repeats are observed in the present recording during its da capo reprise, a practice which I believe to be in line with the composer's expectations at that time. The near equivalence of length in the 6th and 104th symphonies is, in other words, mostly a matter of compositional convention, not dramatic similarity. Speaking of dramatic matters, Haydn composed his early symphonies at a time when an artistic axiom known as the doctrine of affections held sway, especially in stage plays. In those cases, somewhat arbitrary unities were imposed on the work, and these limited the expressive range of the play severely. The musical equivalents can be seen in musical works of the High Baroque, wherein the dramatic posture struck at the very beginning of a movement is maintained assiduously throughout that movement, and any change in drama requires the beginning of a new movement. You can easily find 100 examples of this with just a superficial perusal of works by Bach, Handel, Telemann, Vivaldi, and other composers of the generation preceding Haydn's. That is largely true of the individual movements of Symphony No. 6, whose slow movement, in which the orchestra is reduced to strings only, never rises to a dramatic pitch of any kind. This example may be taken to be paradigmatic of the whole. So, what is there to enjoy in these works? I think that depends on the listener. In one's approach to this music, one should probably first aim for a kind of aristocratic calm like that enjoyed by the Esterhazys, as well as those who had the good fortune to be securely and gainfully employed by them. Haydn was, in my view, the luckiest composer who ever lived. Not only did the Esterhazy family go out of their way to provide everything needed for a vibrant musical environment at court, Prince Paul Anton and his successor Nicholas really understood what Haydn was doing and appreciated it openly. Haydn spent 30 years happily employed by this family, and during that time he did more to define the symphony than anyone else of his or any other generation. If it is true that Beethoven made Brahms possible, it is no less true that without Haydn, we probably would never have had Beethoven. I will take up the movements individually for comment as usual. The beautiful recording you're about to hear is by the Academy of Ancient Music, led by Christopher Hogwood. Movement 1 begins just before sunrise, and the glow of daybreak gradually suffuses the landscape in a short, unproblematic D major introduction that raises the curtain on a bustling and obviously happy scene, an aristocratic court preparing for whatever the day may bring. If you've been following this video series, you may be struck by deep contrasts between this sonata form movement and those of the late masterpieces that I've dealt with earlier. The first theme is compact and yields immediately to a transition which wastes no time establishing the dominant key, a very straightforward, no-nonsense, functional approach. The second group includes not so much well-worked-out themes as a catalog of interesting, contrasting musical ideas that pass in review without much ado and bring the exposition to a close in the dominant key. The exposition is repeated, of course. The development is brief and includes what might be considered a cloudburst, but this does nothing to dampen the spirits of those lucky enough to live at Eisenstadt. The recap is heralded by a horn statement that may remind you of something similar in the parallel moment of Beethoven's Eroica Symphony, composed over four decades later. The recap is almost completely regular, and the entire second section is repeated. There is no coda. The closing phrase is all that's needed to put this movement to rest in the tonic key. Movement 2, set in the warmer subdominant key, might be considered a slow minuet in sonata form framed by a prologue and epilogue. The strings are dropped out of the scoring for this movement, which features prominent solos for the concertmaster and principal cellist. The prologue begins with part of a G major scale that goes awry and soon ends up in the parallel minor. The concertmaster, in order to correct the error, schools the band insistently in the ways of G major, and his fellows nod their affirmation. The prologue begins anew with the same figure, now embellished, and embarks on a sweet duet for the concertmaster and the second violins, ferried along by a progression commonly used at the time and no doubt familiar from Johann Pachelbel's too often played Canon in D. This brings the prologue to its close, and a graceful, stately minuet begins. That minuet is set in the sonata form, with the second large section repeated as in movement 1. This movement unfolds uneventfully, and an epilogue clearly related to the prologue, but set in a more reverent, almost ecclesiastical style, brings the movement to its gentle close. The minuet movement is perhaps the most interesting movement of this symphony, both on account of a very clever reordering of material during its internal reprise and because of its trio, set in the parallel minor and handed over to some of the orchestra's darker voices. This trio might be considered the most archaic music in Symphony No. 6, hewing very closely to Baroque models.
Thank you.
The finale includes all the hustle and bustle one might expect of a symphony of this sort, and furnishes another good example of sonata form as a still young Haydn understood it. This movement features prominent solos for woodwinds, especially flute, for concertmaster, and for the principal cellist. The development is almost completely occupied by a virtuosic concertmaster solo, and the recapitulation is as regular as in the other examples we've seen. This early adventure in symphonic design ends in such good spirits that it's almost impossible for me to listen to it without a smile creeping across my world-weary face.
Thank you.